people who love her. And I intentionally, when I announced the congregation her graduation to heaven, I intentionally did not tell them when it was, because I knew that some people, some rebels, would be like, I don't care about the virus, I'm coming to the end of the day. And I'm just protecting everybody. So good. One of the things that a clergy and a rabbi does is he tries to provide comfort. It's extremely difficult in a time where you can't even like come within 6 feet of somebody, you know, which is the, especially for things like memorials and funerals, this is, you know, can be a time when stuff, so you gotta, but consider each of yourselves virtually hugged. And I mean that really sincerely, because I loved her so, and I know all of you did as well. And so, although there's just you here today, and I say just you, you're the most important people. But at the same time, via that camera, there's going to be certainly hundreds of people who are in participating and enjoying what you have to say also. And so it's not just us here. Truly, the place is filled. But beyond that, I bet, not knowing how these things work, this is not part of this is not part of the service, y'all. Just knowing how God is, I've never thought about this before until just this very moment. You know how people say that the Lord gives people guardian angels to keep watch over them and that kind of thing? You've got to know that Emma had her share because she loved God so much. You know, I got to think that those angels are, you know, real. I got to think that they're here today too, just enjoying the service and being able to see the other side too, you know, and just how beautiful that is. And so, very much so, you're not alone here today. And I was telling a few people earlier. I was telling Jonathan, Tracy, and Monica earlier is that. I don't know how these things work, but if it's possible, I do believe that the Lord letting Emma look over the rail and giving her a big screen of today. And so, knowing her, I know she loves each of you very much. And so, I'm looking forward to honoring her today. And this place is not empty, it's full. And it's full of love. And also, her presence is in this place historically because she was here so much, you know, and loved this place. So none of this was part of the script and all, but I just wanted to share some love with you guys, the family, because I know it's a tough time right now, and maybe even tougher by everything going on in the world. So I just wanted to kind of give my love to you and pass that along. Does all that make sense? So with that, I'll go ahead and start whenever. Do we have everybody here? Okay, good. I'll start. You just tell me when to start, and I can get started. It's going. Okay. Oh, wow. Beloved, although there's not a lot of people physically here, I know a number of people are going to be watching this. And this is also for all of you who are here today. Is it all family? Is it all family here today? And just a couple friends in the back who, and so thank you so much for being here today. We're going to begin with a song that Emma specifically requested be played here today by one of her favorites, Mahalia Jackson. And so right after that song, then we will begin our service today. Thank you.
Yes, amen. Wow. Powerful words. I thought about singing that one myself. I didn't think I'd do it justice. So move on up a little higher. Move on up a little higher by Mahalia Jackson. That was requested by Emma. And how appropriate, right? How appropriate that Emma has indeed moved on up a little higher. A little higher than all, but she really has, y'all. That's beautiful. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Avinu Malkeinu, Father, our King, we humbly come before you and ask you to be with us during this time, Lord. Bless our coming in, bless our going out. We dedicate this time to you. We're grateful to have been touched by our dear, sweet Emma. We bless you, Lord God, even today, B'Shem Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. And let's say, amen.
Amen.
You know, friends, today is a day that we mourn, but it's also a day that we celebrate. We're celebrating the life of an amazing woman. We're here to celebrate the gift that Emma Glass was to all of us. Indeed, we're here to celebrate a graduation ceremony. For as surely as we are here today, Emma herself has graduated to a much better place. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8 says, we are confident, I say, and willing, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. See, absent from the body means to be present with the Lord. And God does provide a plan for such a time as this. In fact, when I met with Emma planning today, she requested the 23rd Psalm be read. And as I read it, let it give comfort to you even today. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Emma had prepared by making the Lord her shepherd. The Lord has led Emma into greener pastures, and Emma will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It's my distinct pleasure and honor to get to share some things with you about the life of Emma. And being its family here, you all know most of it, may not know quite everything, but people watching, it's just an amazing story, a story about Emma Glass. Wow, what a person. Now, I have to tell you first that about 3 weeks ago, I sat down with Emma, because we knew this today was coming. And I sat down with her, and we spent, I don't know, a couple hours together just sitting talking. I asked her so many questions. And I asked her a lot of questions in anticipation of this memorial even. So all of what I'm going to share with you next is straight from Emma. It's a little bit unusual. Normally when I do a eulogy, I have to get information, piece it together from the family when they're in mourning, and it's kind of hard because they're, you know, not focused. They're focused on their mourning, and so it's challenging. But man, I was able to just talk to Emma and get the whole story right from her. And so it was a real blessing. But she wanted for me to make it clear that she was not 100% sure about all the dates. So she said, you tell them, I'm not sure about all these dates. Okay, Emma, I'll tell them. Fair enough, that sounds like her. She wants to get it right, you know. And so Emma Jean Glass, born May 9th, 1945, in Greenville, Mississippi. to Tommy and Lizzie Jean Smith. Emma, the second oldest of four children, with two brothers of blessed memory, Tommy and Richard, and one sister, Mary Ann. Also a dear friend, Alma Jean Rainey, who was also raised as a sister. She was raised in a Christian home, going to church every Sunday to Pilgrim Rest Church. And she told me that she grew up loving God. Her parents were farmers, and she grew up on the farm. And she told me that they grew cotton, beans, peas, amongst other things. She said that she, as a kid, worked in the fields growing up. She said, picking cotton. That's hard labor. She told me that she learned a lot from that experience. And I asked her, Emma, what did you learn from that experience? She said, how to hide. That's what she told me. Tragedy struck early in Emma's life, though, as her mother passed away when she was only 11 years old. Wow. And it made things difficult for her family. She told me that early on she learned how to make money. But she was raised before integration, of course, in Mississippi. And I asked her about that. And she recalled to me how she used to have to go to the back door of restaurants to get food. And she said that she had to eat out there too, in the back. Couldn't go in the front, couldn't eat in there with other people. She told me about how she used to have to sit at the back of the bus. She remembered these things very vividly. She told me sometimes how she and her family sometimes have to hide from white people who were out to get them. That's what she told me. That isn't easy. My gosh, that isn't easy at all, man. And especially with you guys as family members. Wow, she was a pioneer. She broke ground. She was a pace setter. She opened doors for all of you, for all of us, really. Emma was an overcomer, and she wouldn't let things stop her. Emma graduated from Coleman High School in 1963 and eventually ran a laundry business for her aunt for 13 years. She remembered, oh, this is a poignant story she told me about. She remembered getting cancer first when she was 29 years old. 29. And I asked her, how'd you handle that? She told me it was a crisis of faith, even though she knew the Lord, loved the Lord, but that was a crisis of faith, 29. She told me she remembered crying out to God at the side of her bed. And she cried to God, why is all this happening to me? And she said it was at that moment that she received a revelation from the Lord. And the revelation was this, and I quote her, when God's going to come and get me, he'll come and get me. And that gave her great peace. And it strikes me 60 years later, nearly, that's exactly what happened. Just exactly what the Lord told her at 29, when she was crying at the side of her bed, wondering, why could this be happening to me? That's exactly, the Lord fulfilled exactly what he told her. When the Lord's going to come and get me, he's going to get me. He's going to come and get me. And then it's a peace. Emma eventually moved to Missouri, where she spent over 10 years doing home laundry. And great joy came into Emma's life as her family started taking shape. With the different members of her family added to her. Of course, Tanya, of blessed memory, came first. I know that Emma has been reunited with Tanya. Next, in the early 70s, her loving daughter Tracy arrived. And Emma relocated to Wisconsin, met and married her late husband Daniel Glass in 1972. And they'd be married for 46 blessed years. I remember in this place, his memorial just a couple years ago. Finally, Emma moved to Atlanta in 1973, and her son, Jonathan, last would arrive next in order. And man, oh, how Emma loved her family. Goodness. Whew. She loves her family. Emma was always into health issues, as you know. For over 20 years, she worked at Australian Body Works Health Club. She told me the story about how in 1999, they brought her out to some fancy ceremony with Australian Body Works. Big company-wide celebration, feast, and ceremony. And she didn't know it until that moment, but soon discovered that she was named Club Manager of the Year for the whole company. And she said, I was very grateful, but then she was really happy when she found out that the award included a bonus of $10,000. She said, wow, then I was really happy. She was an achiever. Wow, all the things she had to overcome in her life. My gosh. Once in Marietta, Emma attended Jordan Lake Baptist Church for over 10 years. In 1999, she became a part of Beth Hillel, the congregation that we're in right now, that you're sitting in. That's a long time, where Jew and Gentile come together and believe that Yeshua, or Jesus, is the promised Messiah. Yeshua is Jesus in Hebrew. She told me that, I said, you know, why? And she told me that she connected with the people and the message. I asked her if she ever felt unusual at all coming to a Jewish place, and she didn't share in this background. And she told me, and I quote, I thought it was kind of funny that I came to a Messianic Jewish place, but I was seeking the truth. And I would tell people that my Messiah is Jewish, and they left it alone. End quote. Sounds like her, doesn't it? You know I'm quoting her. You can hear it. Oh, how she loved Beth Hillel, and she was so, so faithful. I recall where she always sat, right there, about one pew behind Cheryl, and maybe in a slot or two, or Cheryl's pew. One of those two pews, she would alternate right around there. It's that pew right behind you, isn't it, Cheryl? Right behind you, that's where she sat. I'm talking about for 20-something years. Right there, every time, man. She didn't miss every week. She sat here in this place. The Rigdons, the Fries, the Kirshners, the Perkles, all these people sitting all right around her, all good friends. And Emma was beloved in this place. I know if not for the virus, the sanctuary would be full of people who love Emma. That there's no doubt. She was beloved. She eventually went to work for the late Dr. Carl Bremer of blessed memory, and then came to manage the Beth Hillel gift shop. And she loved it. She loved doing the gift shop. She loved her volunteers and the people who came in. And Emma also very much, as I mentioned, dearly loved her family. She'd speak of them often and talk about how much each of you meant to her. She loved having family all together. She would, taking nothing away from not having other people here, but she would just be thrilled to be with all of you. She'd be quite content. I know how dear she was to each of you also. Emma battled cancer in her body for years, and she fought it well. Even while battling it, though, she fulfilled a lifelong dream and visited Israel last year. She told me, she said, I've never seen anything so beautiful in all my life. I felt the Lord's presence most in Jerusalem, she said. After fighting the good fight, Emma graduated peacefully on March 30th, 2020. Emma Glass is survived by several nephews and nieces, including dear Monica, Alma Jean Rainey, who was raised as her sister, Marianne, her great-granddaughter, Ashlyn, her grandchildren, Philip, Tia, and Roman, and her loving children, Tracy and Jonathan, amongst other dear family members. I'd now like to invite to the stage Dara Vitito and Cheryl Grant, members of our congregation. Emma loved listening to both Cheryl and Dara sing. Emma, I'll tell you this, Emma specifically requested all the songs that they're going to be singing here today. And some have words from the tongue of the Bible, the Hebrew language. And many believe that when we all get to heaven, that's probably the language we're all going to be talking, right? Because there's so many different people. And so it's very possible that Emma, right now, at this very moment, is fluent in Hebrew, which is just wild to think about. So the song is translated in the second verse. And Emma, I'll tell you, the songs that Emma chose here, y'all, are not real down, sad. They're not. They're songs of praise to God. In fact, this song starts off in Hebrew, but then it moves to English. And the whole point of the song is, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. That's what the song says. And so Emma wanted for us to praise the Lord today. So let it bless you as we lift up praise to the Lord for Emma's request.
Hallelujah.
thank you so much. We're going to hear more from them in a little bit. And get comfortable. We're going to enjoy ourselves today hearing stories and hearing things about Miss Emma. I know that it's going to be a blessing. Thank you, Cheryl and Dara. Dara's on staff here at Bethel as our youth director. And so because Emma was here so frequently with the gift shop, they interacted a lot and were good friends. And of course, Cheryl as well. So thank you so much, Psalmist. Absolutely beautiful. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And that's what Emma would want. And I'd like to add a few moments of personal reflection about Emma, and then we'll hear from some different people. But a few things for me, because let me tell you what, I love that young lady too. she's my mom's age. And so my mom passed about 2 years ago, so I know just exactly where you guys are at. And Emma was so solid, she was like a rock. I know she was your family too. Emma was a rock. She would probably shake her head like this, but I could call her a rock star, but I'm not going to do that. But not only did Emma run the Bethel gift shop for so many years, but she also pitched in when nobody else knew that she did. She'd set up communion each month for people when nobody knew that she did that. She helped set up the food after our services, even when she wasn't scheduled to do so. Some people sometimes every once in a while didn't show, but Emma had already gotten it kind of ready to go. And boy, it was not pleasant when somebody didn't show. Emma could not understand how somebody could have a responsibility to God and then let it go. It was beyond her comprehension to understand, and I understand that. But that shows her integrity. She greeted people so warmly and welcome people. She stood in the back and welcomed people when they came in, just so warmly, and it made people feel good inside. You know, when you were around her, you felt good inside. I did. And yes, she was a great gift shop manager. Man, she had a knack about knowing what people liked and wanted. And we spent time talking about this, but she also recognized that the gift shop was a ministry to people because it's help enabling their spiritual walk. Emma loved the Lord so deeply, y'all. So deeply. She told me that she loved to read the Bible. She said her favorite was Psalm 91. But in addition to all of this, Emma was special to me personally. Emma was indeed a pillar here at Beth Hillel. She had such incredible wisdom. To me, just having somebody of her knowledge and wisdom in the congregation was humbling for me. And she'd regularly encourage me. She'd tell me, Rabbi Kevin, don't listen to any negative. She said, your messages are deep, spot on, and just what was needed. And boy, you hear that from somebody of Emma Glass's stature with all of her knowledge and wisdom. And it's like, whoa, thank you, Lord. Okay, yeah, that's encouraging to me. Especially because she was here when I first came in as rabbi. I was pretty young, you know, in mid-30s and kind of new to being a rabbi. And yet there she was, sitting right over there. Boom, encouraging. There have been a few people over the years that I can think of. Don Smith was another who Emma loved and he loved her. But there have been a few people over the years that I could look to help protect the unity that the Lord has grown so strongly here at Beth Hillel. Sometimes Emma would come to me and say, hey, Rabbi Kevin, so-and-so is saying this, so you might want to keep an eye on him. Man, it's like, whoa, yeah, I appreciate that. I'm going to tell you something. She did that just about 3 months ago. She told me so. She said, Rabbi Kevin, so-and-so, I heard, you know, so said that. Okay, Emma, thank you. She was protecting the flock. She was protecting the body. She was protecting her spiritual family. She had such wisdom to discern. She had such wisdom to discern where people were in their true hearts. She really did. And I will really miss this about her. She loved her rabbi. I got to tell you, I loved her. I loved her. I really and do love her. I was touched very deeply that only a couple of hours before she went to be with the Lord, thank you, family, I got a call in the middle of the night, and her literally it was maybe 2 hours before she graduated on up, and her family told me that she had been able to get a word out. She wasn't talking much, you guys remember. And she was asking for her rabbi, and I got a chance to talk with her over the phone. She managed to get a few words out here and there to me, and I prayed with her, and I prayed for the Lord to receive her into his hands. And I sang the Shema with her and the Aaronic blessing over her. I miss her much already. But when I sat down with her a couple of weeks ago to go over this service, of course, she encouraged me. That's just who she was. She encouraged me. She told me to celebrate today because she knew where she was going. And so today, Emma, I celebrate, even with a tear for us. But I know that you are whole, and I'll see you again. Thank you, Emma. You are the mighty one forever, O Lord. You raise the dead sleeping in their graves. You are mighty to save. He sustains life and love. He revives the dead with great mercies. He supports the falling, heals the sick, frees the prisoners, establishes his faithfulness with those that sleep in the dust. Who is like you, Michamocha, the master of power? And who resembles you, O King, who controls death and gives life and causes salvation to spring forth? You are faithful to restore life to the dead. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, who resurrects the dead. One of Emma's best friends was Ariel Lurie. Emma loved Ariel and spoke of her quite fondly to me on multiple occasions. Now, Ariel is from the Ukraine, okay? Emma told me the story about how when Ariel took her to many doctor's appointments, Emma would say to the doctor, yeah, the doctor would be talking and she'd say, yeah, why don't you just talk to Ariel because she's my sister. And Emma told me that the doctor paused a moment, looked at the two of them, and then Emma would say, can't you tell? Which I thought was great. And she even had a warm sentiment that she shared with me about Ariel 2 hours before she went to be with the Lord. Ariel is getting over the flu. It's the regular flu. She was tested. She wanted to come here today, man. It was tough to get her not to come here today. She desperately wanted to be here, and she sends her love to all of you. But she asked me to read this letter on her behalf. So this is from Ariel. Dear family and friends, I wanted to tell you about my sister and about how much she means to me and always will. I am Ariel Lurie, and on March 30th, I lost my spiritual sister, Miss Emma Glass. As much as my heart aches and I can't stop crying over the loss, I know sis would understand my emotions and should say, but think about how happy I am right now to be with our Lord and Savior. And we all know she'd be correct. Let's celebrate the reunion to which she was so much looking forward when the Lord called her home. I'm trying my best to do so, as many of you do as well, I know. We called each other sis because that's how we felt about each other. Emma and I only met about 13 years ago when Mike and I first came to Beth Hillel. Emma caught my eye immediately, right in the lobby. I noticed how gracious she was and how pretty she looked. Perfectly dressed, fashion queen. The brightest smile. There was something exceptional, royal about her. The sunny personality was so apparent it drew many toward it. She impressed me with her kindness and cheerfulness. It was special. I knew that Emma always took copious notes of the sermons, so I was blessed with the opportunity to ask her clarifying questions regarding anything I needed. What a luxury to be able to ask Emma about the Lord's word and teaching. Emma was so deeply immersed in the word. It came to her naturally to guide me and others. Needless to say, we became dear friends, praise the Lord. Emma taught me much. She did not have to do it by lecturing, but mostly by her own actions. Emma never attempted to be the ultimate judge, and everyone around her sensed that. Emma taught me a lot of history and traditions of her upbringing. I've never in my life met anyone who was from Mississippi and grew up during Jim Crow times while loving God's word. And Emma's family connections were differently from what I knew. The love and warmth of such strong people, it was truly an eye-opener for me. Come to think of it, you couldn't have asked for two people from more different planets than us two. Emma was a black girl from the South with all of her spirituality and manners and taste and all. And I was a white girl of Jewish Eastern European heritage growing up in the communist Soviet Union and had very supportive parents but never held the Bible in my life until I came to this country. I strongly believe that the Lord does miracles when we least expect it. Here's a perfect example. He blessed me by putting my sis, Emma, in my path and giving me enough mind to realize what an exceptional gem she was. We became even closer when a few years ago our dear friend Don Smith became bedridden. The love and devotion that Emma showed him was astonishing to me. With this opportunity to spend more time together, my love and admiration for my sis, Emma, grew each day. I did aspire to be more like her. Alas, never even came close. And then this ugly disease attacked. Here's where the true hero, sis Emma, shined even more. Surgery, treatments were enormously difficult, draining her energy every day. No matter how serious and frightening the information and her experiences were, sis never lost faith, never had a pity party. Recovering from surgery, waiting for chemo treatment in the waiting room for her doctor's appointments, not expecting much good news, Emma always remained just as kind and gracious with all the doctors and nurses and the front office staff. She even provided much needed emotional and spiritual support to others who were also fighting cancer. She was loved by all who came her way. She just had that gift. Emma's strength came from the Lord, no other explanation. Lucky me that the love of others for Emma often transferred onto me. Hallelujah. About a year ago, Emma's life dream came true thanks to the kindness of her son, Major Don, and niece Monica. They all went to Israel. She was dreaming to see where it all happened, and she did get to see it. She wrote back to me, quote, "Ariel, I am in love. This is where I belong." Considering that Emma's health condition at the time was not great, this was one of the Lord's miracles that came to fruition. There was just unlimited love and devotion to the Lord's teachings in Emma. She always served faithfully and with gladness. Emma managed Bethel's gift shop for many, many years. When she started feeling tired after her treatments, I hinted that maybe she should cut down on the amount of time she was spending there to have more time to rest. Her answer, quote, "I want to be there and work it. As soon as I come into the synagogue, I am at peace. It heals my body and soul." End quote. Faithful servant, sis Emma was. To her very last days, Emma remained herself, kind and gentle, loving mother and sister and aunt and great-grandmother. Little Ashlyn was so blessed to spend the first 2 years of her life with Nana. One more thing. I'm grateful to Monica and Tracy and Dion for giving me the opportunity to speak with my dear sis on FaceTime on the last day of her time here on Earth. It was so painful for me to be stuck at home on quarantine and not to be able to give sis my last word of love. I wanted to tell her again that I loved her and will always love her. These last few minutes will be ever, forever in my heart as a source of inspiration. Emma didn't want me to cry over her, I know. It's not easy. But she taught me how to overcome obstacles that were not easy. My joy is in knowing that Emma is now walking the streets of gold, singing the songs of glory to the Lord. Sometimes, while riding with me to her appointments, sis would sing for me a little, just to tell me about a song. And she did it very well. I loved it. I know she's doing it even better up there. In her, the Lord must be well pleased. I don't know how we're going to look in heaven, but my best guess is that sis is again the most kind and gracious among many, and her sunny personality gives joy to all forever now. Thank you, Father, for gifting us with this exceptional lady. Sis, I love you and miss you. Thank you for that, Ariel. That was absolutely beautiful to hear. And now, Devetta Miles, come on up. Devetta is one of Emma's great grandnieces. And so we're going slightly out of order in the program, and Devetta will come on up first. Devetta, come up and share a little bit about your great aunt.
Good afternoon to you all. As you know, that was my Aunt Emma. And I could go on and on and on telling the stories about Aunt Emma, but I will tell you this much. She never met a stranger.
That's right.
Never. Yeah. My friends, when they would come around, or we're in Atlanta, or she's even in South Carolina visiting, I'm like, you have got to meet my Aunt Emma. And so one of my best friends, Lakey, got to meet my Aunt Emma at my grandma's house. And everybody knows when Aunt Emma gets a little sleepy, she gets giggly. And her and Alakia laugh so hard, I can't even remember what they were laughing about. My grandma was ready to put them out of the house for laughing. She was always a fun spirit. She saved Dion, oh gosh, she saved her life how many years? When we lived up here years ago, and we were with my aunt before we went to Germany. It didn't matter what we did, Aunt Emma was not going to allow us to get in trouble. If we did something, she'll tell my mom, Monica, leave the kids alone. They're just being kids. John is pulling slugs and putting them in my bed. I fell off. She wouldn't bother him. My sister's throwing cats in the ponds. And it didn't matter what we did. Aunt Emma would not let us get disciplined. She laughed about it and said, oh, don't worry about it. They're just kids. That's what she did. So with that being said, you all, it's not a day of mourning. Yes, we miss her. Lord knows my heart hurts because I miss her.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I know she's resting and I know she's happy. Yeah. Tracy, you were a fashion go-to. Like, if I saw something different on her, I'm like, oh, I am not about that. Where's she? Oh, me and Tracy went so-and-so and we got it.
Right.
Philip, you were just her hero. You were a strong guy. She always bragged about your muscles and how much you worked out. John, oh gosh, she loved you, spoiled right. Oh, did I tell you John did so-and-so today? And to see on your dress blues, that was everything.
Oh,
she'll
yeah.
take a picture every corner you turn in your dress blues.
Yeah.
And Mom, you know Mama, you and I, Emma, y'all have y'all days, y'all fuss, laugh. She'll tell you something, just like y'all went to Israel. I remember you telling me a story. You on a plane sleep. Aunt Emma woke you up, 12 plus hour trip. Get up, you need to walk around, go use the bathroom. I am all asleep. No, you need to move around. You've been sitting too long. So everybody knew my Aunt Emma as the mother of the group. Her and Giovanna would text back and forth. Aunt Emma never was afraid to share her love. You know, with my kids, with my niece, my nephew, if it was nothing more than, hey, I hadn't heard from you, how are you? They'll text her. They have conversations that I didn't even know about. They told me, you know, oh, we'll talk about them every week or every day. We'll text or often I'm in school or whatever. So she, like I said, was a loving spirit. And we need more of that, especially in these times.
Yeah.
I don't care how you felt, what you did at the end of the day, at the end of the conversation, it was always, I love you.
Yes.
And that's just who she was.
Right.
So you all keep your heads up. Remember the good times. Remember she is at peace and she is laughing.
Yep.
She is enjoying herself and she is laughing.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you all. You know, I'm praying for all of us. But this is a time to celebrate. And I'm going to celebrate my aunt because that's who she was. She was fun. She was loving. She was never a down person. I don't care what was going on. I never saw her mad.
Yeah.
Never. She always laughed. Even if it was something bad, she might say whatever she's going to say, and she's over it. We're laughing the next few minutes later. So don't cry. Maybe for a little while, not long. Don't cry. But smile. Remember our memories. Remember the fun times we had. And we'll live with that. And we'll be happy with it.
Amen.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Wow, that's clearly somebody who knew him, if you can tell, huh? It was close, you know, and knew her character. Wow, that was just right on. Thank you so much, Devetta. That was beautiful. From Psalm 8, when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor. I'd like to invite up Deoncia Cannon, one of Emma's great nieces now, to read a special poem that she wrote. Deon?
Permission from Aunt Hilda to sing the teapot song.
Oh, no.
But it's okay. I won't sing the teapot song today.
But she told me I could sing it, but that's what I wanted to. But instead, I'll read this poem.
If only for a moment, if only we could have held on to you a little longer. We remember seeing the warmth of your smile and feeling your warm embrace. For it was your smile that brightened our days and brought us so much peace, happiness, and grace. But most of all, we will miss seeing your face and being able to partake of your loving embrace. You never let the grass grow under your feet as you traveled the world, visiting the Holy Land in Israel, which was well-deserved and oh so sweet. So, as you wave hello and goodbye to us, we won't make a fuss. We know you wouldn't want us to mourn, but to rejoice, knowing that you're in exalted hands and resting according to God's holy plans. Your loving niece, Deoncia Cannon.
Wow, that's probably known in the family, but she's obviously a gifted poet. And so that was beautiful. Thank you so much. And that was fitting tribute, Deon. Now, we're going to hear, of course, from Devetta and Deoncia's mom and Emma's niece, Monica, who spent a great deal of time, of course, taking care of her aunt, was beloved by Emma. So, Monica, come on up now.
This is just something that I created for my aunt from Israel. Oh, no. I'm sorry. And for you. Thank
Good afternoon.
I'm not going to be sad. I'm going to rejoice for my aunt because that's what she would want us to do. And I was thinking, since last Monday, what would I say about my aunt? Because there's so many things and you can't get it all in. And the one thing that I kept coming up with was no regrets. I came up with no regrets because my aunt Emma used to always tell me, you're the oldest of all the kids now. You've got to do what's right regardless of how hard it is. As long as you do what's right, everything else will fall in place. So that's one of the things that I've taken from my aunt Emma. If I can be half of the woman that she was,
right,
I'll be a great woman.
Yeah, that's right.
We loved her, and we all know Aunt Emma did things in her own way, in her own time.
Yeah.
And she's gonna run everything that she can. We sat with Cheryl one day and she was telling me what she wanted and telling Cheryl what she wanted. She was like, I like this picture right here. This is the one I want on my picture. I said, Emma, that one right there, you're not looking at your eyes. Me and Cheryl said, no, that's the one I want on my picture. And I remember becoming so full till all I could do is say, I gotta go check on my dog. Because I couldn't cry around Aunt Emma. She didn't believe in crying. So I went, did my little week, and came back upstairs. But I won't have any regrets. You know, a lot of people, when somebody leaves this world, they regret they didn't do this, they regret they didn't do that. I have no regrets.
Amen.
I sat in the hospital with my aunt 3 years ago for 12 days, and I took care of her. And she used to always say, baby, you ain't got to do this. I know you want to go somewhere. I'm like, Aunt Emma, I'm with you for the long haul. And God knows, I was with her for the long haul.
Yes.
I have no regrets. I love her. We're going to miss her.
Yeah.
We're going to miss her smile. I'm going to even miss her fussing at me for something I didn't do. She helped raise my kids. She raised her kids, and she raised anybody else's kids that needed
help. That's right.
That was our Emma. So our Emma, I'm not gonna say so long. I'm gonna say I'll see you later.
That's right. Good. It's good. Thank you, Monica. There were times where she helped raise a rabbi too, I'll tell you. she just had so much wisdom, you know. Thank you so much. Now we're going to hear from Cheryl and Dara again with a song of praise, praising God, that Emma loved. And the name of this song is called Hallelu et Adonai, which essentially is, let's praise the Lord. So we're going to hear now from them, and then we'll hear some more people share some beautiful thoughts. Cheryl and Dara sing, right? They both can sing, and they both can praise the Lord. That's the most important thing, you know, with something like this. And so, thank you so much. And you can hear in the songs that Emma chose, even though maybe you don't know them, you feel them, and you know what message she's trying to communicate. It's like these songs are about praising God, and that's what they're all about, and they're all so beautiful. So thank you so much again. Cheryl and Dara with a wonderful blessing. Now we're going to hear from Emma's daughter, Tracy. Tracy, we want to hear your thoughts about your mom, who you loved and who loved you so very much. So Tracy, come on up and share your thoughts.
Hello. Time trying to decide what I want to say. Couldn't really decide really what I want to say because there's so much I wanted to say. But I remember she used to make clothes for my sister and I. She used to love. She always had us all dressed well. She always took really good care of us. It's probably where my little fashion came from. She loved keeping the house perfect. Everything had to be perfect. And she was quite creative. She would make pillows anything. She would always try to find a way to save money, and she would ask me how the outcome of it was, and her work was always beautiful. Several of the pillows, she even made curtains one time, and they were gorgeous. I admired her for being so strong. She always told it like it was. She was dedicated to whatever it was she put her mind to, and always completed the goal or the task. She was a faithful woman to her synagogue family, her friends, acquaintances, whoever it might have been. She always showed love to everyone. She always stood by the family, no matter what. I will miss hearing her voice, her loud laughter throughout the house, and most of all, her face, and knowing that she was never far from me. I love you, Mama, and I'll see you again soon.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Yes, thank you so much, Tracy, and you will. And I'll tell you, you know, even you talk about seeing her face, and when I'm looking over here and I can see your profile as you're talking, I see her face in your face. And so she's with you. Even when you look in the mirror, you can see she's with you. So, wow, that was a fitting and beautiful tribute to your mom. Just amazing. Man is like a breath. His days are like a passing shadow. The years of our life are 70, or even by some reason of strength, 80. Yet they're soon gone and we all fly away. So teach us, Lord, to number our days so that we may get a heart of wisdom. And finally, we're going to hear from Emma's son, Major Jonathan Glass. I see of a lot of attributes that you share with your mom, John. Let's hear from Major Jonathan now.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca. Really appreciate you doing this for us. And good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming here today to celebrate the life of my mom. Okay. Just compose myself here.
Take your time.
Okay, so growing up, my mom taught me many things as a young kid and allowed me to develop into who I am today, like good manners, respect, sound moral values. She was the foundation of our family, ensured everyone had a good home-cooked meal every night, clean, pleasant home to come home to, and encouragement when times were rough and you were down on the feelings, was always there to bring you back up.
Right.
Mm-hmm. My mom ensured that every special occasion, be it birthday, Thanksgiving, Christmas, was truly special. The house would always be decorated. Birthdays, you know, we had the cake, candles on it, of course. Have, you know, banners, balloons. Christmas, always have lights up. Christmas trees, you know, decorated out.
Yeah.
Stockings hung from the chimney with care. then Thanksgiving. Yeah, she really went out for Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
She'd start preparing, you know, a week out. She'd start buying groceries, make sure, you know, she basically had to have something, you know, you're guaranteed she's gonna have something, you know, your favorite dish was gonna be out on that table. We'd have the full spread. And then being who she was and always kind, she'd also invite anybody over that she knew was going to be alone for Thanksgiving. So we frequently had guests that would come and eat with us. And it's just a wonderful feeling of togetherness. It was special times.
Yes.
And then I always think back to our spring break and summer trips where we'd go to the beaches, or the mountain, or Disney World, went there frequently. You know, she always make sure, you know, we got everything packed up, weren't forgetting anything. And then as always, my dad would always wait till, you know, that morning. He'd be like, well, I gotta go do this on the car, gotta fix something.
And yeah, she would get so upset.
Yeah, she would get so upset, like, really? You knew we had this long drive and you had to wait till the day of to do this. So she would motivate him to speed it up so we could get on the road before too late. Then when we got to our destination, we'd always have a good time, whether it was, you know, you all pulling a fish out of the lake and then panicking because it was still flopping around and everything. Disney World were always fun, although she, you know, me and my dad, we like to the teacup rides where you sit there and it's basically however fast you spin it. And so, of course, me and my dad thought it was fun to see just how fast we could spin it. She didn't like that. I don't think my sister liked it either. Yeah, so we thought it was the funniest thing. Yeah, so she also forged me into a hard worker.
Yeah.
Like growing up as a teenager, you know, she always had me doing things around the house. And you had the regular stuff like lawn mowing, but you know, house needs a new roof on it. Hey, go put a new roof on there. Like, I don't know how, but right. So, yeah, she always had me doing that. And then as I got later into adulthood, every time I came home to visit, you know, because I was going, you know, going everywhere, especially once I was in the Marine Corps, I've always gone somewhere. But if I came home, she always had that sudden to-do list, like, okay, here you go, I need to fix this, that, the other. I'm like, okay, Mom. And always gave her a hard time about, you know, like, oh, I can do this, but, you know, in actuality, I liked helping her around the house. And then also paid off for me, because now whenever I need something done on my house, I know how to do it, so that helped out. Also, as you all know, my mom was really, really outgoing, and she'd make friends with everybody wherever she went. I was always amazed at her ability to not only strike up a long conversation, like she'd go and, you know, talk to your neighbor for like half a day. But then she would actually like listen to them. So she would come back and like start telling you. And I think back in 2014, mom and dad basically found out when I was flying back in from being deployed out in Afghanistan. And so they didn't tell me, they drove up to North Carolina. And so I step off the airplane, they're on the tarmac to greet me, you know. And so, you know, of course they come and stay over at my place, and as a few days they were there, I was like amazed, because she'd like come back and be like, start telling me stuff about my neighbor. I've been living there for like a year. She like told me more about my neighbor than like I've been living there for a year. Okay. And like you were saying right by Kevin, it wasn't for this whole COVID-19 panic. This, I know the synagogue would be filled. And then, like, you were also mentioning, my mom had a tremendous sense of dignity. And, you know, you could tell, like, you were talking about from her, you know, her manner of dress and her style. Tremendous sense of dignity.
Yes.
You would never, you know, catch her outside the house, you know, and you know, torn clothes, wrinkled, like not wrinkled clothes, ain't none of that. Like, if I would try to leave the house with, like, you know, clothes that were a substandard of me, I'm always like, it doesn't really need to be wrinkled. And she like, she wasn't happy. She'd be like, give it to me. I'll iron that shirt for you. Like, I can't. Yeah. It's a, and then her sense of dignity, feels, was never so tested nor so well demonstrated as in the final few weeks of her life. With her body riddled with cancer, she still didn't want to take painkillers, because she hated, like, she just hated not being able to talk to her friends and family. Like, she told me, you know, hey, they make my mind fuzzy. And, so she was in pain, but she didn't want to take painkillers because she didn't want to lose that ability. So I struggled to imagine myself being able to meet death with like 1/10 the dignity that I observed my mom over the past few weeks. It's really swelled me with pride. Yeah. So, in conclusion, I'll continue to strive to live my life the way my mom taught me to work hard, to be kind to others, and to exercise sound moral values. Yeah. These values made me who I am. Yeah. And so for that, I thank her very much. Thank her for everything she's given us, the warmth we shared during the precious times of her being on this earth.
Yes.
I am glad that, you know, the pain has gone away, and I always love her. But of course, I'm gonna miss her.
Yes.
Until we meet in a better place.
Yes. Right.
Amen.
Yeah. Wow, boy, I tell you what, that is should have been really proud of every one of you who spoke.
Yes.
Every one of you who spoke, she would be. You know her. You know how proud she would be of every one of you who spoke and what you said. That was amazing also, Major. Thank you. And you're so right. I got to tell you, I really relate, especially with my mom having just passed not that long ago, too. I think our moms were similar in a lot of ways with that kind of Southern class, but that strength. And your mom was like that for sure. Wow. Thank you so much. Major, I have some concluding thoughts that I want to share with you in a few minutes and some are of some substance. But first, a final song. This was requested by Emma also. And this song is called The Days of Elijah. And it talks about the coming of the Lord riding on the clouds. And we look forward to that day because should the Lord come back, we're still alive, we'll meet the Lord there. We'll see Emma, at that time, you'll see your mom, your aunt, however late, your friend, and so we look forward to that day. So I'm going to go ahead and help Cheryl out, if you'd all stand.
Desert. are the days of Ezekiel, the dragons becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days.
Riding on the clouds, the Lord's going to come back, and what a beautiful day that will be when that trumpet sounds and we will see him again. And what a beautiful day that's going to be. I know I'm looking forward to that day as well. Adonai Natan, Adonai Lakach, Yishem Adonai Mevarach. The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Emma is now in heaven where there is no sun, there's no moon, there's no night, no tears, no death, no sorrow, no pain. The light comes from the Shekinah glory of God. The walls are made of jasper, and Emma is walking down streets of pure gold. How do I know where Emma is? Emma prepared for this moment. She prepared for right now. How do I know this? Well, Emma understood the scriptures. Man, she understood the scriptures better than the rabbi. And she understood what the scripture said about our need for an atonement for our sins, forgiveness, a blood covering. This is where that perfect blood sacrifice of the Messiah, Yeshua Jesus, fulfilled the requirement for us for all time. We should all, family, friends, anybody watching, examine our lives today and ask ourselves, have we prepared our lives to be with God? Emma loved the Lord so very deeply. Nothing, and I mean nothing, nothing would make Emma happier than to have her memorial to serve as a time where some make a move to follow God or to do so more fervently. The fear of death is canceled by faith in Messiah. 1 Corinthians 15 says, in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Well, finally, I have a message for some of you today. Because when I met with Emma 3 weeks ago, I asked her, we could really talk. Him and I could just talk turkey, if I could put it that way. You know, we had such a good relationship. And I asked her if she wanted to pass along any thoughts for me to say to you today. So I specifically told her, I said, Emma, for this service, this memorial, once you've gone on to heaven and everybody's going to be sitting there, is there something that you want me to say? So, something from her. So the following is from Emma in her own words, knowing that they would be spoken today. To her Bethel family, she said, I quote, I always loved you and always will. Don't take it for granted, as so many do. I'll see you in the sweet by and by.
She also told me that she'd be looking up Don Smith, she'd be looking up my mom, others, that have gone before us. To her gift shop volunteers, she said, "I'm glad you were in my life. I wouldn't change things for the world." To Ariel Lurie, she said, "You've been like a rock to me, and I'll miss you. You've been there for me. You're my best friend." To Monica, she said, "I have so appreciated how you've come to take care of me so often. After my surgeries too, you've been like an angel to me." To Roman, who she also, as a side note, when it came to Roman, made a point to mention to me, you know, he's in the gifted program at Tread. Okay, I got you. So she was proud of him. And she said to Roman, "I love how kind in spirit you are. You'll do whatever I ask to be done. I love how you say grace. Mm-hmm. Nana loves you." To Tia, and I know, but Emma knew, "Ashlyn has been such a joy to me. Do what is right and do the things you should be doing. I have hope for you that you will realize how you can do what is right. Press in with God. I have a lot of hope for you." To Philip, "Do the best you can do. You've been with me every day. I appreciate it a lot. I love you, and keep being the type person that you are. Press forward and never throw in the towel." To Tracy, "The only thing that you can have that will get you through life is God. Hold on to him as tightly as you can. Thank you for helping to pitch in and help out so much. I love you." To Jonathan, "Grab a hold of God and hold on to him. Even when you don't feel him, he'll get you through it. And I want you to know that I'm always there with you. You've been like a lifeline to me. I love you." She also told me that even not knowing her, she was praying for your future wife. Finally, Emma wanted for me to tell you all of you, "Love the Lord with all your heart and strength. I've reached out to serve him every day. I love the Lord and look forward to being with him." Emma wanted me to tell you that all that she's in heaven in a better place. Now, knowing that all of this would be deep and emotional, and I've barely held on right there myself, and knowing that this part would be, I asked Emma if she had a little joke or something that I could insert. And she said, "Rabbi, I'm not a joke person." Which I thought was pretty hilarious, actually. And then she said, "I want a celebration because I'm going to celebrate with God. I'm not crying." Fair enough, Emma. So we're celebrating with you. Let's bow our heads. God of mercy, please be on the Glass family. Touch them, God. Minister to them. Comfort them, Lord, in their time of mourning. And although they mourn, Lord, it's a different kind of mourning because we know where our loved one is. We know where Emma is. God, she's with you even right now.
So Lord, the prayer is not for Emma anymore. Emma is totally healed. The prayer is just for this sweet family and those watching who loved Emma. God, please be with each person, God, and let them carry that which Emma tried to instill into them the rest of their days and pass it on to the next generation. So God, that's my prayer, is that which Emma wanted to instill in them would take deep root. I know that's what she would want, Lord. Be with them, comfort them in difficult times, provide for them. We ask these things in Yeshua Jesus' name, amen. As we prepare to conclude, I'm struck by the passage from Scripture from 2 Timothy chapter 4. Rabbi Shaul Paul the Shaliach, the Apostle, says, "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." We'll conclude this day and this time with the priestly benediction of Aaron from the book of Numbers. If you'd please rise and bow your heads. This is taken right from the word of God. God commanded Aaron to proclaim this blessing over the children of Israel. And also, this is the final prayer that I prayed over Emma just about 2 hours or so before she went on to heaven. And first it's in Hebrew, and then I'll translate it to English. Yivarechech Adonai v'yishmarecha Ya'er Adonai panvalecha v'chunecha Adonai pan v'lecha v'yasim lecha shalom. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. B'Shem Yeshua Sar Shalom, in the name of Yeshua Jesus, the Prince of Peace. And let us say, amen.
Amen.
May God comfort you among all the mourners of Zion and Jerusalem. Baruch Dayan Amet. Blessed is the righteous judge. And this will conclude, Dara, this will conclude our memorial service. Thank you so much for coming, and let the Lord bless you in Yeshua's name. Amen.
Virtual hug, y'all. Virtual hug. This honor for in the right way. This honor for in the right way. So that you all be blessed and know that you honored her right. And those things that she said to you, I hope touched you. I hope spoke to you. And blessed you. And she was telling me, I was like, whew. I was tapping him on my phone, and I was holding back tears at the same time. It was so beautiful and how thoughtful. Thank you all. And thank you for coming and for this sweet honor. So your love on each other. I'll say this too, especially to you guys. If there are times in the future, you know, where sometimes a week, a month from now, where suddenly, just unexpectedly, you just find yourself start crying, it's okay. It's part of the mourning process. And Emma will excuse it. I'll talk to her about that, okay? And that's okay. That's part of the healing. Okay. I'm relating with you. I've been there a long time myself. But know where she is. Watching over you. Trust me, she's talking to God about each of you and saying, hey, you think you can help them? Lord, do you think you can help? Hey, God, angels, you think you can help? You know she's doing that. All right? So love to you guys.